Hello, boys and girls. Before we get started on Chapter 7, I have two things I wanted to do. First of all, I wanted to wish my student Ziva a happy birthday for Monday, March 23rd. And I wanted you to notice that I did a little sketching, and I encourage you to do the same as we read this book together. So I started trying to imagine what Uncle Henrik's house was like, because I know they say in the story that he lived down by the water, and across the water you could see Sweden, and I wondered what it looked like. So maybe I'm wrong in my drawing. Maybe it doesn't look quite like this, but I wonder what you imagine. Let's read Chapter 7 and see what you learn about the house by the sea. "Oh, Annemarie," Ellen said with awe in her voice, "it's beautiful." Annemarie looked around and nodded her head in agreement. The house and the meadows that surrounded it were so much a part of her childhood, a part of her life, that she didn't often look at them with fresh eyes. But now she did, seeing Ellen's pleasure, and it was true, they were beautiful. The little red-roofed farmhouse was very old, its chimney crooked, and even the small shuttered windows tilted at angles. A bird's nest, wispy with straw, was half hidden in the corner where the roof met the wall above a bedroom window. Nearby, a gnarled tree was still speckled with a few apples, now long past ripe. Mama and Kirsty had gone inside, but Annemarie and Ellen ran across the high grass meadow through the late wildflowers. From nowhere, a gray kitten appeared and ran beside them, pouncing here and there upon imagined mice, pausing to lick its paws, and then darting off again. It pretended to ignore the girls, but looked back often to be certain that they were still there, apparently pleased to have playmates. The meadow ended at the sea, and the gray water licked there at damp brown grass, flattened by the wind and bordered by smooth, heavy stones. "I have never been this close to the sea," Ellen said. "Of course you have. You've been to the harbor in Copenhagen a million times." Ellen laughed. "I mean the real sea, the way it is here, open like this, a whole world of water." Annemarie shook her head in amazement. To live in Denmark, a country surrounded by water, and never to have stood at its edge? "Your parents are real city people, aren't they?" Ellen nodded. "My mother is afraid of the ocean," she said, laughing. "She says it's too big for her, and too cold." The girls sat on a rock and took off their shoes and socks. They tiptoed across the damp stones and let the water touch their feet. It was cold. They giggled and stepped back. Annemarie leaned down and picked up a brown leaf that floated back and forth with the movement of the water. "Look," she said, "this leaf may have come from a tree in Sweden. It could have blown from a tree into the sea and floated all the way across. See over there," she said, pointing. "See the land way across there? That's Sweden." Ellen cupped one hand over her eyes and looked across the water at the misty shoreline. That was another country. "It's not so very far," she said. "Maybe," Annemarie suggested, "standing over there are two girls just our age, looking across and saying, 'That's Denmark.'" They squinted into the hazy distance as if they might see Swedish children standing there and looking back. But it was too far. They saw only the hazy strip of land and two small boats bobbing up and down in the gray ruffles of separating water. "I wonder if one of those is your Uncle Henrik's boat," Ellen said. "Maybe. I can't tell. They're too far away." "Uncle Henrik's boat is named the Innenborg," she told Ellen, "for Mama." Ellen looked around. "Does he keep it right here? Does he tie it up so that it won't float away?" Annemarie laughed. Oh, no. In town, at the harbor, there's a big dock, and all the fishing boats go and come from there. That's where they unload their fish. You should smell it. At night, they are all there, anchored in the harbor. Annemarie, Ellen, Mama's voice came across the meadow. The girls looked around and saw her waving to them. They turned, picked up their shoes, and began walking toward the house. The kitten, who had settled comfortably on the stony shore, rose immediately and followed them. I took Ellen down to show her the sea, Annemarie explained when they reached the place where Mama waited. She'd never been that close before. We started to wade, but it was too cold. I wish we had come in summer so we could swim. It's cold even then, Mama said. She looked around. You didn't see anyone, did you? You didn't talk to anyone? Annemarie shook her head. Just the kitten. Ellen had picked it up, and it lay purring in her arms as she stroked its small head and talked to it softly. I meant to warn you. You must stay away from people while we are here. But there's no one around here, Annemarie reminded her. Even so, if you see anyone at all, even someone you know, one of Henrik's friends, it is better if you come in the house. It is too difficult, maybe even dangerous, to explain who Ellen is. Ellen looked up and bit her lip. There aren't soldiers here, too, she asked. Mama sighed. I'm afraid there are soldiers everywhere, and especially now. This is a bad time. Come in now and help me fix supper. Henrik will be home soon. Watch the step there. It's loose. Do you know what I have done? I have found enough apples for applesauce. Even though there is no sugar, the apples are sweet. Henrik will bring home some fish, and there is wood for the fire. So tonight we will be warm and well fed. It is not a bad time, then, Annemarie told her. Not if there is applesauce. Ellen kissed the kitten's head and let it leap from her arms to the ground. It darted away and disappeared in the tall grass. They followed Mama into the house. That night, the girls dressed for bed in the small upstairs bedroom they were sharing, the same bedroom that had been Mama's when she was a little girl. Across the hall, Kirsty was already asleep in the wide bed that had once belonged to Annemarie's grandparents. Ellen touched her neck after she had put on Annemarie's flower-sprigged nightgown, which Mama had packed. "Where is my necklace?" she asked. "What did you do with it?" "I hid it in a safe place," Annemarie told her. "A very secret place where no one will ever find it. And I will keep it there for you until it is safe for you to wear again." Ellen nodded. "Papa gave it to me when I was very small," she explained. She sat down on the edge of the old bed and ran her fingers along the handmade quilt that covered it. The flowers and birds faded now, had been stitched onto the quilt by Annemarie's great-grandmother many years before. "I wish I knew where my parents are," Ellen said in a small voice as she outlined one of the appliqued birds with her finger. Annemarie didn't have an answer for her. She patted Ellen's hand, and they sat together silently. Through the window, they could see a thin, round slice of moon appear through the clouds against the pale sky. The Scandinavian night was not very dark yet, though soon, when winter came, the night would not only be dark, but very long, night skies beginning in the late afternoon and lasting through morning. From downstairs, they could hear Mama's voice and Uncle Henrik's talking, catching up on news. Mama missed her brother when she hadn't seen him for a while, Annemarie knew. They were very close. Mama always teased him gently for not marrying. She asked him, laughing, when they were together, whether he had found a good wife yet, one who would keep his house tidier. Henrik teased back and told Mama that she could come to Jillilajay to live again so that he wouldn't have to do all the chores by himself. For a moment, to Annemarie listening, it seemed like all the earlier times, the happy visits to the farm, the happy visits to the farm in the past with summer daylight extending beyond bedtime, with the children tucked away in the bedrooms and the grown-ups downstairs talking. But there was a difference. In the earlier times, she had always overheard laughter. Tonight, there was no laughter at all. So as you can see, boys and girls, my picture isn't quite what they described in the story, but maybe you could draw one, and maybe you could put the kitten somewhere. And where would the old apple tree be? And how far away would Sweden look? Try to picture this place, boys and girls, and try to notice the little details that the author has put in, and think to yourself, why is it there? Why does the author mention the necklace again? Why does Mama worry about soldiers way out here? Why is there no laughter when the mother and her brother catch up? That's it for tonight. I hope you do well. We'll see you for Chapter 8 tomorrow.